Great. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now you can continue.
Okay, so I would like to quickly summarize the structure of my presentation. I will talk about the motifs for emerging of urban agriculture here in Bulgaria, about the scope of urban agriculture. Then I will present to you four case studies, which are a result of empirical research, which I conducted at the end of 2017. After that, I will present the positive factors and obstacles in the development of urban agriculture in Bulgaria, and we'll end with some conclusions and considerations about further development. Next slide, please. Urban agriculture is generally a result of totally new social processes which can be found worldwide. Later on, I will come back to these social processes in my presentation. Now I want to tell that there is a totally new phenomenon on the world scene called new alternative agriculture, and urban agriculture is part of it. Also permaculture, biodynamics, regenerative agriculture, climate smart farming, they all are different and interconnected processes in the so-called new alternative agriculture. Urban agriculture in Bulgaria originates from 2011. It is mainly concentrated in the capital, in Sofia, but also spread later on in six more cities, Plovdiv, Varna, Ruse, Burgas, Vidin and Sliven. I will present to you quickly the results of four case urban studies. Next slide, please. The first case study is about permaculture educational gardens, which are a project of one of our NGOs, All Together Foundation. This project began in 2011 with 3 years long funding project. This organization began to grant small funding to kindergartens, which were inspired to build small educational gardens in their yards. So this project was very successful, and 10 gardens in Sofia were created. Later on, 5 more gardens around the country, in Plovdiv, Varna, Burgas, Vidin and Sliven. The main concept of this NGO was to educate first the directors and teachers in kindergartens and the parents. And after that, the idea was to spread these new gardening skills and community spirit to children in the kindergartens. Because this project was very successful, in the next years, it spread to our Bulgarian schools. About 100 schools were inspired to begin such small permaculture educational gardens in their yards. And it was within an information campaign of that organization, which created very good educational materials about the permaculture principles, about permaculture flower, about rotation of plants in the garden, and so on. And they gave online and free public access of this to these materials. After that, many other projects were boosted to start to elaborate their own small projects in the schools and in kindergartens. Please, next slide. Uh, Next slide will present to you the case study tool. This is a typical form of urban agriculture, and it is about a community urban garden, also in Sofia, which is a project of the Free Center with Horizontal Structure for Urban Farming Sofia. It began in 2013 in one of Sofia districts, Nadezhda. Because the municipality pushed them out from the land plot when they already have created a garden, they in 2015 the participators in this project found a new plot in another district in Sofia, Druzhba, and they created a new community garden on 2.5 acres land plot. The good point here was that the municipality company gave them free rights for land usage, free access to water, and free security. As of 2017, the participators of this community garden decided to terrace the whole land plot and to divide it into 23 small gardens for each small team of participants. So nowadays they have about 30 to 40 participators in the community. These are predominant young people between 25 and 35 years old. And despite of planting very high diversification with crops, they also have beekeeping. Very interesting fact about the management of this community garden is that they have a pretty horizontal structure. This means that all the decisions are taken from bottom up, and there is a general assembly where everybody who takes part in this community can propose and take part in the decisions. So this is a garden from people to people and very open to the community. Also very important is that all the costs are covered from members of the community garden. They definitely refuse any kind of grants, of public grants, municipality grants, and so on. They believe that this is the sustainable way of developing of such a kind of community garden. Case study three, please. Next slide. Case study three is again about a community permaculture garden in the center of Sofia in district Vitusha. This is a so-called Bio Garden Vitusha. This garden began in 2014 with a small permaculture training for the volunteers who were involved in the creating of this garden. They created a spiral, circular, high-raised plant beds and also planted a high level of diversified crops. Nowadays, this garden is mainly educational garden for children, many green schools, are organized also trainings for refugees. Definitely, the access to the garden is absolutely free. After some years of developing, in 2017, the same two organizations, NGO Štěslivice and Bio City Sofia, decided to start a new project, Museum of Bees, in the center of Sofia. So these are real beehives in the center of Sofia, and they, with this initiative, they want to increase the city culture about beekeeping. Also very important is that for these both projects, they have free land usage granted from Sofia municipality. They also used small business grants and private sponsors for supporting their activity. Next slide, please. This is a case study four, and this is about a private project called Micro Salads of an Urban Gardener from Sofia. He started in 2016 on a very small scale, on 1/4 of an acre. Before this year, he has purchased bigger plots outside the city, and he faced the administrative bureaucracy in public funding. After some experience in this, he decided to go small and to be inside the city. He chooses this marketing strategy for his small urban business. The first picture on the slide is before developing the small garden. The second picture is during the building of a greenhouse on the land plot he owns. And the third picture shows some of the planting in the greenhouse, which are available currently in the greenhouse. Very specific for this urban gardener is that he grows in his own home some of the seedlings and microgreens, because his strategy is predominantly to grow microgreens and baby vegetables. His market strategy is oriented towards restaurants, which are specialized in culinary arts. Next slide, please. After summarizing the results of these four case studies, and after researching the public information about other forms of urban agriculture in Bulgaria, it could be concluded that there are some very positive factors for emerging and development of urban agriculture in Bulgaria. First of all, these are social processes worldwide. In the last 20 or 25 years, we can see on the world scene a new attitude in people to nature and to biodiversity, a new attitude to healthy food, to social and ethical motives, new attitude to business and its results. As a result of these social processes, we can see new movements which are from bottom up, like the slow food movement, like the growth movement, like the Commons movement and the European Commons Assembly, and other bottom up movements which boosted these processes, like urban agriculture, like alternative agriculture. Also, the influence of social media is very important in these processes. Another positive factor which I have seen is are the personal characteristics of practitioners of this kind of agriculture. I've met very optimistic people who feel satisfied from gardening, who love working with children, who are devoted to communities, who are also resistant to challenges, and who desire to gain new knowledge and spread it further in their communities. Have relative good attitude on small projects. Also, in contrast to non-urban permaculture farming, urban agriculture has relative good access to municipality funds, micro funds, and private sponsors. Next slide, please. Very important is also to summarize some of the obstacles in the development of urban agriculture. First of all, this is the old mentality of many urban people. There are many people who still consider farming as something dirty, unworthy, not prestigious, and even have fears of that. Another obstacle is the lack of enough experience and knowledge in gardening in many participants in urban agriculture. Many have very high first enthusiasm in beginning such initiatives, but after facing the challenges, many tend to give up. This is especially valid for subsidized projects. We have seen many abandoned gardens after the funding finishes. That is why I have mentioned that for case study two, the community urban garden, they have very important principle to refuse all kind of subsidies in order to secure further sustainability of the garden. Another obstacle is the common agriculture policy in Europe and the subsidies in agriculture, which are mainly for monocultures and for large-scale projects. And another specific for Bulgaria is the uncontrolled import of cheap agricultural products, which create disloyal competition and are a great burden in front of developing of urban and not only urban permaculture farming as real entrepreneurship. Also, one specific is that municipalities tend to refuse written agreements about giving the land rights for usage. This creates a high transactional risk in front of the participants in such projects. They cannot rely in the long term on the land plots they want to build. There are also infrastructure problems as watering, the need of high investments for building of rainwater and greywater urban systems. And one specific for the Bulgarian urban agriculture is that it is at the moment still a very small scale because the majority of Bulgarians haven't still lost their connection with villages. And they have many small projects in the villages and not so many in the cities. Next slide, please. So it's time to summarize some conclusions and considerations from the urban agriculture research in Bulgaria. So I found a great potential for further development of urban agriculture in Bulgaria. And this is also the opinion of all the participants which took part in this research, despite all of the obstacles and difficulties they have in developing these initiatives. Next conclusion is that having urban agriculture on this initial stage, we actually have a stable path towards increasing of social capital in the Bulgarian community. Social capital means that qualities like cooperation, personal motivation, tolerance, respect, and volunteering prevail over the pure financial goals and results, which are very typical for conventional agricultural systems. And another conclusion is that already in the Bulgarian kindergartens and schools are sown the seeds of curiosity and happiness in our children, and they are the next generation which will follow us and develop further the urban agriculture in Bulgaria. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm open for questions here live, or you can contact me also via email, which is given here in the presentation.
Thank you very much, Donika. So now it's time for questions. As I understand, the question is mainly about the social functions of urban agriculture or permaculture. rather than growing the food.
So,
do you have any experience that people become totally self-sufficient from these urban farming projects?
Not totally self-sufficient. I cannot say that any project here in Bulgaria, urban or not non-urban, is totally self-sufficient. This is still like a fiction, but I can with great security say that they have some self-sufficiency about producing a lot of a great amount of food in these community gardens.
Вирощуючи багато їжі в цих садках. Є питання? Немає, так?
Українською?
Ну, українською я потім перекладу.
Скільки людей в столиці, скільки людей
So could you give some numbers, how many people, for example, in the capital city are involved in this kind of projects?
In the capital, I cannot say with security the number of people, but for every of these four projects, I would say about 40-50 people per project. So these are four projects, 200 people, and there are also another project, small projects, which are more educational projects, another educational gardens with another NGOs. So many, I would say, more 200-300 people, not more.
Сказали, що, можливо, це 200-300 людей здійняли цей проєкт.
Чи дозволяється місцева влада висаджувати фруктові дерева?
Ага.
Маска, ви місцева забороня.
Yeah, so are you permitted to plant the fruit trees in the cities? Because, for example, in Ukraine, sometimes it is forbidden.
It is forbidden from municipalities, you mean?
Yeah, from municipalities.
Yes, so we don't have such rules. Yes, we have permits. If we can agree this with the local municipality, so there are many small local municipalities around the capital, and it's up to every single agreement. So it's possible, yes.
Визначається індивідуальними взаєминами, тому це можливо. Тобто індивідуальними домовленостями з муніципалітетами. Да, зі школами працюють. Ні, ну в школах вони. Да, в школах. So the some of these gardens are created inside the schools. Or rather, you invite the children to come to some garden?
So they are created inside the schools and inside the kindergartens. So they are in the yards of the school or in the yards of the kindergartens. And they serve as education in gardening skills, in community skills for these children.
Uh-huh. Да, тобто вони створені школами. So who in the school, who is responsible for this kindergartens? Like who of the school administration is responsible?
The directors and the teachers are responsible, and they work together with this NGO All Together Foundation, which are the initial organization who started to build such kind of educational projects in Bulgaria. So they serve as tutors, and they give them learning materials, and so they consult them in this activity.
Вони проводять заняття
в спеціалістики і обучення, які вже розуміють, що
Yeah, so the question is who is conducting these workshops or training? Is it a trained professionals who, let's say, you train, or you just provide the materials to the teachers and they are free to
conduct? I see. It's both. It's both. So the organization provides all the materials, but also the trainings. They train the teacher, they train the directors, and they train some of the children. And after that, the director and the teachers are responsible to further train the children in the schools and in the kindergartens.
Вчителям, викладачам, директорам, і після цього вже вони можуть проводити це навчання. Я думаю, що на цьому завершимо. Да. Окей, Донька, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, too.
Fine presentation, just to add something. We have the whole other section dedicated to the education, and there will be a lot of presentation about school gardens in Ukraine. So now, thanks to some activists in Ukraine, this is growing very fast. So we need to think about some possible collaboration between our.
Absolutely, yes. This this sounds very great, and thank you very much. We'll for sure stay in further contact for the future.